Goodness gracious.
And
goodness gracious.
And we're back?
Question
and
mark.
Rob's back.
It felt like that demanded a question mark.
One of us is not on.
Oh, there we go. Sorry about that, AMC Mike.
Was it me?
No, it's AMC
Mike.
They didn't
want me.
It's AMC Mike. AMC Mike.
Rob's having trouble turning AMC Mike on today.
No longer.
All right.
He doesn't have that problem anymore.
No longer.
Knows all the right buttons to push.
We worked it all out.
We did.
We are back. I'm Rob Alderman. With me, as always, my stalwart traveling companion, except for, like, I haven't been around.
That's true.
So now it's, like, with you, as always.
With me, as always.
As sometimes.
And with Rob, as once in a while.
Right. With me, as sometimes. With him, as always, the lovely and talented AMC Mike.
Oh, thank you.
And my brother, the Ken Dog.
I'm here, as well.
And Dakota, who was promised early on that she'd get to sing a song.
If she behaves.
So you listen to Lights, Camera, Cleveland on 99.9 Whoop FM. Rob picks a topic. Ready? Go.
Nerds are mad today. They are angry because they say that Quicksilver, they've released the artwork for the Quicksilver for the new X-Men.
Yes, they have.
And they are furious because he doesn't look like Quicksilver from the X-Men. And this reminds me of a nerd alert that I saw most recently on AMC Mike's Facebook page regarding a Ninja Turtle that had bro'd out with a pair of sunglasses and like a
what?
Armband. So here's my question.
We talked about that last week.
I didn't see that.
We talked about it last week on the show.
No, it came afterward.
Oh, was it afterward?
Yep.
Oh.
So Mike,
I saw like the bad Halloween costume.
What happened is they accidentally released one of the Halloween costumes that's based off of his design.
Yeah.
So that's an indication of what the turtles are going to look like.
So here's my topic.
I think they looked great.
To what extent do nerds have a say in what a movie guy is going to have his movie look like? I asked this starting with the Slinky because, as we all know, Slinky wants to make the movies. He's written the scripts. He spent the time at the Universitate. So my question, Ryan, is if you are going to make a movie like the X-Men, how beholden are you to, say, Quicksilver's costume or to which turtle got destroyed?
Michelangelo.
Michelangelo.
Yeah.
Where? And then we're gonna let.
If
we're gonna
any turtle's gonna bro, it's him.
Then we're gonna nerd out. Gonna nerd out about this. But I want the straight scoop.
All right. Here's what I think. Here's the deal. Some movies. I think it depends. We gotta start at the beginning, I guess. It depends.
Here we. Let's go all the way back.
Long time ago.
Let's go all the way back to the first time somebody ruined a costume.
There once was a time.
Yeah.
In a world. All right, here's the deal. In movies, okay, I think it depends on how you set yourself up. For example, if you recall the very first X-Men film, okay, X-Men came out, and in that movie, they were all wearing these black leather suits. I mean, they had black leather
X's
on them.
Yeah, they had X's.
But they were all modeled in this black leather thing because they were attempting to
look kind of like a paramilitary jumpsuit.
Right, but the whole point mostly was to make the X-Men accessible as a real thing. Because up until that point, we had proven over and over and over again that with the exception of Christopher Reeve as Superman, when you put actors in spandex and call it a superhero movie, it is often death at the box office.
Yeah, oh yeah.
So Bryan Singer said, maybe the problem is the spandex. Maybe we need to just reel this baby up. And so he did that. He kept all of the fantastical science fiction elements, but what he did was he put them in believable costumes.
Right.
And most people said, you know, I would have liked to have seen Wolverine in his brown and beige suit.
I want to see that, but only to shame him.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Yeah.
But, you know, most people were okay with it. They got it. All right. And so I feel like because this is in the Bryan Singer universe,
right,
where he has already established that they don't
wear spandex.
They don't.
That's the picture?
Yeah, we're.
That's Quicksilver?
That's Quicksilver.
It looks like a lady.
Yeah, it does look
like a
little bit
college
like
teen.
But the actor looks like a lady. Though.
Like she should be going to get in her Volkswagen Bug
but the
and
actor,
take a midterm.
The actor is very feminine looking.
I just
he played the ghost guy on the first season of American Horror Story.
Okay.
He kind of is. He's kind of feminine looking.
Well, and isn't he gonna? Aren't they gonna go that route with the character?
I mean, the way
that it's been written. I've heard that they are. So I'm just saying that. But, and he's French. I'm just saying that too.
He's French.
Oh, so, that explains so much. No, sure, of course that's what he looks like. When you picture that, when you look at that picture, and you picture him in downtown Toronto.
Yeah.
Oh, right. There you go. That's Quicksilver.
Is there a coffee shop? Maybe I can get a cigarette.
I think it looks like a costume that was accidentally rejected by the Matrix.
Right. So here's the thing is I think that when you have a movie that has already established that nobody's going to wear the costumes that look anything like the comic book, I think that you're being a poop head if you're going to throw fits that suddenly, five movies into this franchise, one character isn't dressed like he is in the comic. That's ridiculous. Give me a break. Now, having said that, if you have a movie like Spider-Man or you know, well, Spider-Man is the big example. You have a movie like Spider-Man. Spider-Man looks like Spider-Man. Looks like Spider-Man.
Right.
And so his bad guys kind of need to look like his bad guys do in the comics a little bit. And so far they have.
Yeah.
You know, the other end to that is sort of what Marvel has done.
I don't think we've ever actually given high fives to that Spider-Man series either, because they've actually done a good job of keeping him looking like the...
Costuming.
Yeah.
I mean, because I was going to say, when you said Christopher Reeves, I mean, Spider-Man, the recent Spider-Men movies have been fairly successful with a...
Both the
spandex base,
the Ted Raimi ones, and the Andrew Garfield ones.
Yeah,
I don't know what that means. You're talking about
the three movies with
Tobey Maguire.
With Tobey Maguire, versus the new one with the kid
with the
Andrew
hair.
Garfield.
Yeah,
I liked both. Yeah, I liked them.
And they look good,
but they're different.
Yeah,
but now when you compare this to the Marvel movies, Marvel has kind of established that the characters, if they are a main top-tier level character, they will look mostly like they do in the comic.
I found
with a touch of that realistic element added to balance it out.
I felt like Singer made a good case for this because he said, I didn't want people laughing at them the whole time.
Right.
Like you put if you had them all in this yellow and blue, but we just started our team spandex.
Right, exactly.
You know, people are going to spend more time laughing and debating.
Well, you want people to be going, yeah.
Debating the size of their private parts
and
such.
Hugh Jackman is Wolverine. You don't want them to be sitting there the whole time going, look at his junk.
Right, exactly.
The thing is, Singer made those movies
nerds are pervy. Geeks?
Singer made those movies not for the comic book people.
Okay.
I was working at a...
You have never worked.
I have worked.
That is a lie.
No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
I remember when I was talking to someone about the Singer X-Men, and a woman came up to talk to me, and she was like, oh, I love Wolverine, you know, which right away I was like, all right. But... And then she started telling me, and I was like, "Have you
She's
ever
like, snickety snackety?"
Yeah, no, but she it wasn't like a creepy kind of thing. It was more like she was like, "No, the character's so cool." Like you, like she she's watched all of the Wolverine movies and all the X-Men movies, and she told me all about them. And finally, I was like, "What did you think about their costumes?" And she was like, "What do you mean?" And I was like, "Well, they're not like they were in the comic book." And like she really had that it was a comic book look on her face before. Like she had no idea. These movies were made, at least look-wise, for
people that didn't
read the
comics. No, I totally agree with that. They were trying to broaden the audience.
I think they tried to broaden the audience. I'll tell you though, as a comic book guy, and I had said this to Ryan when they came out, you know, I said, look, dude, Brian, I've been waiting for these movies like my whole life. You know what I mean? Like ever since I learned about X-Men and read X-Men as a kid. So for me, you know, I had waited and waited and waited for this. I wasn't gonna let like a costuming decision bother me. And it didn't bother me. So even as a comic book guy, it didn't bother me.
Yeah, you know, my biggest issue has been that Halle Berry doesn't have a mohawk yet.
My biggest issue is Halle Berry can't act.
Well, sure, but if you're going to have a crappy actress, I mean, at this point, you can't recast her. She's been in like 12 of these movies.
Yeah.
So let's embarrass her with a mohawk.
Whatever,
right?
The mohawk was awesome.
I liked Mohawk Storm.
Yeah.
And I liked other Storm. I mean, Storm's a cool character, and I don't hate Halle Berry in the movies.
I
don't think it's written terribly well.
The accent bugs me.
It's just not written
Sometimes the accent's there, sometimes it's not.
So now let's move to part two, though. Now here's part two.
African.
What about this Ninja Turtle broing out? I'm not trying to make the house be divided. But my point is, like, the turtles have been tried in many different ways.
Yes.
Yes.
They've been tried in so many different ways. Like, and let's be honest, like, we're talking about a bunch of, like, pizza-eating bros, right? Like, that's what they are anyway.
Makes sense
to me.
Not to mention, when he's trying to fight Shredder, what if there's, like, a glare? What
and if he needs to put those sunglasses
on? What if he's
got to
put those sunglasses on? I didn't see the picture. What is the picture? Like,
really,
is he wearing, like, a polo with the collar popped?
What if it's J.J. Abrams' cinematographer and so there's lots of lens flares?
Do you remember the next mutation?
No. There was a series in the 80s that was Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and it was done by the Saban Group, the folks who do
Power Rangers.
Right.
And so it was a live-action Ninja Turtle TV show.
Okay. Done in the style of Power Rangers.
Okay, do you remember when they did the Pizza Hut concert Ninja Turtle where they went around singing songs?
No, and let me stop you there. I read the comic, the original, I believe, right? You had the original, right?
Yeah, bunches of them.
So other than...
I don't talk about it much because it's kind of Carrie's jam.
Other than that, so you gotta stay like away. That's kind of in my mind the original.
Right, absolutely, it is.
That's kind of been the majority of my exposure to Ninja Turtles. Other than that, I know they kind of made it for kids and you know all that, but So in my mind, when you start saying, you know, do you remember this incarnation and that incarnation, I don't, because
he just remembers
nice, big, chunky, three-toed turtles.
Right. I'm a casual...
Two toes. There's three toes in the new cartoon.
Three fingers, right?
You've just entered a whole other argument.
Didn't they have three fingers?
Am I going to get to see his picture? I want to see this guy. I want to see him with his collar popped. I want to see...
He's got, like, a funny little dog tag, too. Hold on. Here he is.
Yeah, like, they've... I mean, it's just weird looking. It doesn't...
Because it's a Halloween costume!
Yes, but we can all look and imagine what he's going to look like in the movie if that's what it's based off of. And, you know, it's creepy
looking.
Here's
the thing. I think it's important to remember, and don't get
mad. Are you mad that he's wearing jean shorts?
First of all of it's ridiculous.
It's all ridiculous looking.
He would wear jorts. Oh, I have no doubt in my mind.
Of all the turtles, Michelangelo would wear the jorts. Never stop
believing. Technically, he wouldn't need to because his junk's covered by the shell. I have trouble sometimes. I'm not saying all the time because, you know, if it's my fandom, they can get away with murder. But when it's your fandom, I can say, that seems unrealistic. Honey, you live on a spaceship. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I look at it and I'm like, well,
I'm just saying,
what if this was leaked?
This is what Halloween costumes do, AMC Mike. No. They look horrible.
No.
Halloween costumes look horrible. You
guys are not going to be able to argue and say that Michael Bay's version of the Ninja
Turtles
are
going to be awesome. That's one of the best Halloween costumes I've ever seen.
Awesome.
Okay.
Except for I was already against it when they said Michael Bay.
Well, that is true.
I mean, I didn't need the costume controversy.
Okay. So then you look at, for instance, you guys hate the Transformer movie, right?
That dude is fierce.
Mostly, yes.
Yeah, the first one is okay.
Okay. So I would say, as the demographic, I'm much broader. When the Transformers movies came out, I looked at them and I was like, that looks really, really cool. I thought visually they were awesome. I had problems with the size a little bit.
Yeah.
Just spatially, when they transformed, I thought they were too big transformed.
They don't have enough mass.
You know what I mean? That was my problem. The math didn't work.
Yeah.
Right.
But when the Transformers were fighting in downtown, it's pretty awesome.
But the way it looked, I thought was amazing. I feel like he's going to broaden it, and the way it's going to look will probably be...
retarded.
Pretty good.
I don't know.
I mean,
Michael Bay doesn't typically have a problem with visuals.
But see,
I would disagree,
and I think the Transformers is the perfect example of it.
He made it too complicated.
They are so overly complicated in their design. I mean, it was one of the criticisms of those films was that when they were leaping through the air,
it just looked
like a bunch of scrap metal.
Well, that's
especially true. When they were fighting.
The ones that looked like insects were difficult to watch.
So anyway, I think with the turtles thing, I think the real issue really lies in just the fact that Michael Bay is not the man to have this vision. And the other problem with it is that right now Nickelodeon is doing a new cartoon of the Ninja Turtles, and this new cartoon is actually pretty well 100% agreed, like, the best version of the Ninja Turtles outside of the comic books to ever be presented to
the public.
The
original comic books.
And so there is this feeling amongst most turtle fans that says, you know, if this is doing so well and has captured our turtles so well, then why don't you just make a movie, you know, have this cartoon series have a 2-hour movie at the theater?
Well, yeah.
So animated?
I'd be for that, too.
It's animated, you say?
Yeah, it's animated.
Now, can
it's,
I don't
it's
think com- that's
it's completely good.
Yeah, but I don't think
as
that's
these
the
discussions tend to do. Ryan did bring up something that I didn't know was an issue. I didn't know there was a debate between 2- and 3-toed turtles.
That is true as well.
The new Nickelodeon cartoon, for whatever reason, has added a third toe
on their feet.
Here's
to
the
their
thing.
Feet,
in the okay,
which is where toes go.
They
if
have
you think
always
about a real turtle though.
They have always
got 4 feet with
on. In all incarnations, they've had 2 fingers and a thumb.
3 feet.
Right.
Yeah, okay, yes.
An opposing digit.
Right.
Because it's tough to grip your nunchucks
right.
otherwise.
Now, on their toes, traditionally, in all formats except for this newest cartoon, they have had 2 toes that stick out the front, and then the
their
ankle,
heel.
The ankle.
A little nubby
or the,
heel.
The heel kind of sticks out a little bit more in the back as if it were the third.
Something to balance
the
on.
Third toe-ish, the right. thumb. But this new version on Nickelodeon, they actually have 3 toes on the front of their foot and no ankle, heel, toe thing.
This is that so they can grab nunchucks with their
I have no idea,
toes?
But for some reason, and like to me, I don't care. But for some reason, amongst diehard turtle fans, this is a huge debate.
It's me out.
It's like
creepy.
She's
I
bothered
just have
by
to
it.
Say it kind of bothers. I've not seen this cartoon. I can't tell you why it bothers me, but just having you describe it bothers me. Mostly, I think, because when I was in my comic book phase, okay?
Right.
You know, back then.
Back in September.
Yeah, like a month ago.
Pre-marriage.
When I first when I first kind of got into comics, I really quickly got into some of these black and white comics, like Boris the Bear and Usagi Yojimbo and like Lone Wolf and Cub and this, right? And one of the things
because he knew in his mind that someday he needed to be a hipster when it came to comics.
When it was
like,
going
to
take
someday I have to try and attempt to out-cool Carrie.
Oh, no, that's impossible. That's why I said I don't even talk about owning these comics much because your wife's the guru.
You know, can I tell you?
But what I was going to say was this. For me, a lot of liking that comic was that the Ninja Turtle comic didn't look like any of those other indie comics.
Right.
Like none of them. And part of it was like this chunky toe. They were like massively
now the
built. Like they were very
they
like.
Lay on it, yeah.
You know, right. So there was sort of like this. I've not seen anything that looks like this.
Sure.
You know, and so to think that somebody would mess with that is a little weird.
The next time you come over to watch Hell on Wheels or something, you know, they're only like, you know, 20-minute cartoons, so maybe we'll show you one just so you can see it because they're pretty good. But as a funny side note, I have a funny AMC Mike is the expert on all things Ninja Turtle story. We were at a Comic-Con in Houston, Texas, a few years ago.
Okay.
And Wizard Magazine, which is like, you know, the undisputed king of all things comic books, they had this booth where you would stand in line for like an hour. And when you got up to the front, you spun a wheel and it would land on a prize level, you know, like a prize value.
Right.
And then they would ask you, you know, what's your favorite genre of comic books or what's your favorite, you know, comic book character? And then they had this like million page book of like questions about every single comic book character ever. And they would ask you a hard trivia questions because they were giving away good product. Right.
Okay.
And she got up, and after waiting in line forever, and she spun the thing, and she spun like $10 or something. It was kind of a disappointment, but whatever, you know, that's not
the
point.
It was fun.
So, and she's like, Ninja Turtles. And they're like, okay. And so they spend a minute, and they look it up.
Well, and then they were like, which version? And I'm like, any.
So they finally,
because you're legit.
Yeah. Right.
So they finally go, all right, well, here's one. And they give her this question about the very first couple of issues of the very first Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle comics ever, right? And they're like, how, what was the question? Do you remember?
They asked me in what issue the Shredder was killed.
Right. And so, Carrie said,
I was like, I can't remember if it's five or six. And I was like, so, okay, I lose because it's five or six. I don't remember.
Right. And didn't you just pick one, though?
I think so,
I think
yeah.
She just guessed five or whatever. And they were like, no, sorry. You know, it's... And the number they gave
no,
was...
No, they told me... They were like, no, he actually died in the very first issue.
And she went, no.
No.
And so she made them over a $10 prize. She made them look it up because she knew she was right. And so they spent a minute Googling it and looking it up. And when they were done, they were like, holy crap, you were right. And so they gave her this like $200 miniature bust of Ron Weasley.
Because here's your consolation Weasley.
Because they were like,
that's like when we used to have the Whitney horn.
Yeah, and they were like, I feel so bad that you were right and we were wrong that not only am I going to give you a prize, I'm going to give you like one of the most expensive prizes.
It wigs
prizes
me out that
there
is a $200 Weasley in existence.
It wasn't that
but
much.
But I'm glad that you own one.
Yeah.
It's, you know what? It's kind
of
fun.
Every once in a while we get a little bit of a fun thing that happens on the show. And I just got a text from long, long, long time listener Nathan Johnson.
Oh.
Of all people. And he said, I put a picture on your Facebook page. So I went to go look, and it was on our Lights, Camera, Cleveland page. And it says, forget about Quicksilver. Why is 2-1-B from Empire Strikes Back trying to kill the mutants? And he's posted this photo.
Is it the picture?
And he's not wrong.
Is it the Sentinel?
Yeah. That's frightening.
That is awesome.
Somebody's definitely ripped that off.
The new Sentinel looks like 2-1-B.
Yeah, it does.
The new Sentinel looks like 2-1-B. So, two things. Glad Nathan's there, and glad that he's still protected the Star Wars.
Yeah.
That's a medical robot.
Yes.
He's taking an oath to do no harm. How is he going to...
Because
this is not okay.
It's because mutants are a genetic anomaly.
Oh, and so he's trying to fix it.
Yeah.
Makes perfect sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're on board. All right, folks. Mm-hmm. Well, you're listening to Lights, Camera, Cleveland on Whoop FM 99.9. We got a great show. We've got the box office numbers, some big news. We've got a couple of preview reviews, and later a very special report from Carrot Cake involving the Swedish version of the Oscars.
We'll be right back.
Boom, boom, boom.
And we're back. You're listening to Lights, Camera, Cleveland.
You can find us on whoopfm.com if you are needing to stream online at 99.9, if you are needing to listen to the radio. If you got to listen to us later, you can find us at lightscameracleveland.com.
Heck yes, you can.
And normally we're on the blue chat, but if you are trying to get onto the blue chat tonight, please be aware that for some reason we do not have internet here in the studio.
No internet.
So everyone can go talk. I just can't.
Yeah, we just can't see it.
Can't see it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you know, talk.
Please.
So there you go.
Please discuss. Please. Discuss 2-1-B. Discuss broed out Michelangelo. Discuss Quicksilver from Toronto. The more I think about him being a feminine Canadian, I just don't have a problem with it.
Doesn't really bother you.
Anyway, none of that has anything to do with you hitting me with some box office numbers.
Gonna start with number 6 because the only movie that opened new last week placed 6.
Fair.
I, Frankenstein. $8.6 million. Did anyone see this movie?
I thought you and AMC Mike were gonna go.
No, you know what?
I'm so tempted.
It just looks fun and bad.
Yeah.
Yep. I agree.
But I don't know that I want to pay full price for fun and
Here's
bad.
The thing is
it looks like everything that I
on
told
the big
you.
D.
It's everything I told you movies like Hansel and Gretel are supposed to be.
Yeah, and I liked Hansel and that's what I'm saying. I liked Hansel and Gretel, so maybe I'll take Ashley to this. She
there
liked
you
Hansel
go.
And Gretel.
Maybe
you
we'll,
know,
maybe,
let's go see it, man. We'll let's just go see it.
Dubla dating.
It's on
I'm
the,
for it.
It's on the big D. Let's go and not expect it to be good and just expect to be like...
Can you do that, Slinky?
Here's the big issue.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think he can. Here's the big thing like that Ashley
says.
I went to
Escape from Tomorrow.
Whatever.
You had hoped
listen,
it was good.
There's no movie as bad as that movie.
Oh, is that a challenge?
Hey, did you know?
No, please, AMC Mike.
Because Here Comes the Devil.
I can think of a few that are actually worse.
But I do want to say, though, bad. For folks listening, though, the MES events are awesome. The movies are not always good.
It just
sometimes
depends.
They're great.
It just depends on what you want.
And actually, I believe that Movie Todd and I are going to go see The Visitor this Saturday. So
there you go.
I don't know. I can just tell you that Escape from Tomorrow wasn't my kind of movie.
But we had a great time.
But we had a good time, and the girl next to me spilling her beers all over my feet seemed very nice.
Right.
And
AMC Mike and Movie Todd went last weekend to the MES event and saw Here Comes the Devil, and they had a good time.
I've lost like 20 pounds so that I can go more comfortably next time.
And maybe fit in the seat.
And,
we just sat in the first row. It was way easier.
Oh, man, that would be so much better.
I gave her that advice.
We were there early enough to sit in the first row, and then like we didn't realize how the thing worked, and we let the this is so bad, but it's actually true. The body odor got to us. There were some people there that had not. I'm being honest. There were some people that began to really.
It's kind
really,
of a hipster crowd,
and there were maybe some unwashed beards.
Right,
and we like sought like some refuge in the corner. The next thing we knew, the whole first row was taken.
Right,
so you know, that's how that was.
So there you go. Number 5, Jack Ryan, Shadow Recruit. $9.1 million, bringing its 2-week total to $30.5.
What? Now, this you guys would have covered while I was out of town.
Mm-hmm.
Did anybody give this a great?
I don't believe so.
Did everybody give it a...
Yeah, I think Ken Dog did.
Did you grade this, Jack Ryan?
Yeah.
I don't see why it would be any worse than any of the other Jack Ryan movies. That's fair. I really liked him at the beginning, but they don't...
And Dances with Wolves is in it, so that's good.
Well, that's
and
true.
I thought he did some good lines in the trailer.
All right.
So there you go. Number 4.
Number 4.
This one was actually number 5 last week.
Do
it's
you
creeping
want to
back
build
up.
A snowman?
Frozen at $9.1 million, bringing its 10-week total to $347.9 million snowmen.
Snowman. It doesn't have to be a snowman.
Yes, it does.
Axel sings
Olaf
songs.
I like musical
songs.
Us.
My kids are singing that song. In summer. And the Axel tried to sing it big with the vibrato. It is awesome.
I was in some meeting where somebody was just singing it to themselves like over and over.
Was
and
it Dan Buck from the Ocoee Theater Guild?
No, but that would be perfect. I forget. I was sitting in
he
a
was
meeting
here
with
last
somebody.
Week and was like all about
I
it.
Was sitting in a meeting with somebody and they were kind of like... And I was like, I just kind of stared at him, and he looked at me. He goes, "I don't know what to tell you. My kids got the actual, whatever the soundtrack is, like the
okay, yeah,
you know, not like the pop versions, not the Disney. And
ew.
So they've been listening to this thing over and over again, and they were like, it's melted my brain.
Yeah, it'll do that. I've played it many, many times for my children's."
Snowman, are there any other good songs? Because that's the only one. What's the one about like, the cold never bother me anyway?
All of Kenny's kids want him to take them to see it a second time, but he was like, no, I'm a bad dad.
Yeah.
I'm not comfortable with that.
I said,
and then he was like, only if you pay for my ticket too.
Maybe this bee's a chance for Uncle. Maybe.
Yeah, he actually.
Well, no,
told
it wasn't me.
One of his kids was like, well, I'll just pay for my own ticket, and then he was. That's how she talks. And then he
she's
was
a
like,
Southern Belle.
And then he was like, well, who's gonna take you? And she's like, well, I'll just pay for your ticket too.
No, she didn't.
And then you were
like,
and then you were like, do you know how much that is? Let me tell my story.
Okay.
And then you were like, do you know how much that is? And she was like, well, it can't be more than 52 cents. And you were like, it's $30. And she was like, well, maybe we'll just wait for Vidya.
Vidya.
That's pretty good, dude. Oh. That's kind of that's exactly
we
how
were drinking
Axel talks.
Mint juleps.
That's exactly how Axel talks. Well, Father. Father, I do declare I would like to go see a film this weekend. Isn't it delightful, the talking snowmen and children that were left out in the cold at the age of 6 to be raised by goblins and never heard from in the town again?
I think I would like to go see the nut job.
My kids have been asking.
My kids,
like,
no.
Listen, dude, that one, the nut job ranks as my least favorite kids trailer in years and years and years and years.
They
want to
see it so bad.
And my
thing.
Kids want to see it because they keep putting fart jokes in there.
Well, you know what? The nut job placed number 3 at $12.1 million. 2 week total, 40.1. You know, I mean, maybe we ought to make
it. Do you want to see the nut job?
Maybe we need to. That was my fart jokes.
Yeah.
Maybe we ought to. I mean, you know, Dakota would go see that one. Maybe we ought to just make an adventure out of it one day.
It'll be an adventure.
Number 2, Lone Survivor. Spoiler alert, Lone Survivor.
Survivor.
$12.9 million, bringing its 5 week total to $93.9.
Now I'm going to interject here. Ryan and I saw a movie.
Yes, we did.
And we were trying to decide what movie we're going to see.
And so, by the way, you guys will have 5 questions for us here in a little bit.
Yeah. What movie, and maybe tell us sooner next time.
Just
well,
make up 5 questions.
We saw Anchorman 2. We went and saw Anchorman 2 the other night. But as we were going down the list, what was funny is the first text comes across, and it's the text I never would expect to get from Slinky that says, want to go see 12 Years a Slave at 10:30? Like the 10:30 p.m. showing of 12 Years a Slave. And I was like, yeah, I'll go. And it was like quickly followed up with, or Anchorman 2 at 10. Like, it was like, but we were looking, and the box office was so freaking depressing. And we actually had a conversation like, well, do you want to go see Lone Survivor? No, you know, he goes, no, because, man, I'm going to just be honest. Like, Ken was telling me about it, and he's going through the whole thing, and he's like, and I mean, apparently at the end of it, and I mean, I'm not making fun of you.
Right.
He's having a normal conversation. He goes, you know, Ken was telling us about it, and like, apparently at the end of the movie, you know, like, only one guy lives, and then he kind of caught himself, and he goes, which I guess I would have known by listening to the title. And it was just like, that's where. So we saw Anchorman 2.
Yeah.
Instead. We didn't want to get depressed by 12 Years a Slave.
Well, and 12 Years a Slave started a half hour later and was a half hour longer. So we were just like, do we want to be out till 1 or would we rather be out till 1 going to Steak and Shake afterwards? And
we chose Steak and Shake.
So, and it was a good call. It was a good call. So number 1. Rita Along, as my notes say, though I believe the movie is Ride Along.
Yeah.
It might be funnier.
Showing you that Ice Cube still delivers.
$21.3 million for its 2 week total of $75.5 million. Thank you, Chris Hart and Ice-T.
Ice Cube. Gosh.
You know.
I think it's Cube, bro.
All those ices look the same to me. Just the
That's
ices.
That's a good movie.
Vanilla Ice.
You. Did you see it?
Ice tea.
No.
Ice
you know what, man? You are rapidly losing. Like, when you, here's the thing, dude. I love having you on the show, but you are the king of, like, I like these movies. These are going to be good movies, but you never see them. Have you seen The Peoples?
Well, it's because my wife doesn't
have
go to
Pain
bed
and
Gain. 8 o'clock.
Have you seen Pain
and Gain?
And I just
go out
or The Peoples.
And see movies.
Have you seen Pain and Gain or The Peoples?
I have seen Pain and Gain.
Did you like it?
No, it was horrible. We talked about it. On this show, we talked about it.
We don't listen to the show, Kenny.
Yeah, I don't listen to the show. It was ridiculous.
One of the worst movies I've ever seen.
So you think Ride Along is going to be awesome?
I think it's funny.
You know what? I've heard enough of Ride Along here on our radio show to know that I don't need to see it.
Yeah.
Yes, but when you hear it, is it funny?
When you and I do it.
I'm pretty sure that's exactly how the movie goes, though.
I'm not
not so sure.
I'm not so sure either. I don't know. You know what? Here's the one thing I'll say. It looks very... Well, the one thing I could maybe compare it to were some of those Chris Tucker, Jackie Chan movies.
Shanghai?
You know, like Shanghai or...
Shanghai Noon.
What were the Rush Hour movies?
Rush Hour?
That's what I'm saying. The Rush Hour movies. I don't remember how many there were. But anyway...
At least two.
The Rush Hour movies were actually a lot funnier than I would have thought.
Sure.
And so, you know, maybe Ice Cube is angry Jackie Chan.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly what... Wait, what, a black man can't be Laurel and Hardy?
That's not what I'm saying he can be.
What, a black man can't be Abbott and Costello? I almost said Elvis Costello.
I thought you almost said LL Cool J. I was like, actually, a black man is LL Cool J. A black man is
Ladies love LL Cool James.
I know they do.
Lady.
I don't even know he sings that song.
Kenny Rogers, dude. All right. Well, we're going to be back.
We will be back.
That's a fact.
Go, Ninja. Go, Ninja. Go. Go, Ninja. Go,
here we go.
Ninja,
go. Lights, go, camera, ninja, Cleveland.
Go, 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 go.
You brought the noise with this.
I did.
We'll be right back. You listen to Vanilla Ice.
From the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Go, Ninja. Go. Lights, camera, Cleveland.
Gonna rock the town without being seen. Have you ever seen a turtle get down? Slamming and jamming to the new swing sound. Yeah, everybody let's move. Vanilla is here with the new jack groove. Gonna rock and roll the place with the power of the Ninja Turtle bass. Iceman, you know I'm not playing. Devastate the show what the turtles are saying. Ninja, ninja, rap. Ninja, ninja, rap. Ninja, ninja, rap. Give it up for the heroes in green, just flowing smooth with the power, kicking it up hour after hour. Cause in this life, there's only one winner. You better aim straight, you can hit the center. In it to win it with a team of four Ninja Turtles that you got at the door. It's Ninja, Ninja, Rap. Ninja, Ninja, Rap. Ninja, Ninja, Rap. Go, 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 go. Go, Ninja, go, Ninja, go. Go, Ninja, go, Ninja, go. Because one day you might not slide. So choose your weapon, don't slip. Vanilla's in control with the flex of a mic grip. Rocking the crowd the way it should be rocked. With the Miami drop, that's it like a lot. You know it's hidden like a ninja turtle. When the bass kicks in, you better check the level. The power of a ninja is strong. Fighting all creeps until they're all cold gone. Ninja, ninja, rap. Ninja, ninja, rap. Ninja, ninja, rap. Go, 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 go. Go, ninja, go, ninja, 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 go. Go, 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 go. Ninja, Ninja, rap. Ninja, Ninja, rap. Ninja, Ninja, rap. Go, 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 go. Go, Ninja, go, Ninja, go. Go, Ninja, go, Ninja, go. Go, Ninja, go, Ninja, go. Go, 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 go.
Out with the gladiator.
Sent me a you know, a script and everything, tell me what was going on in the movie and what was going to be happening. You know, they told me all about this whole scene. It's exactly like they, you know, they had it wrote down and everything, and told me to write and make it ice.
So we did make it ice.
Made it ice.
And so I was like, I just love, you know, to have the turtles. I love the turtles, and I love the turtles. And so I was like, I was going to say, go ninjas. And then I was like, I was all, go ninjas.
Go.
And then I was all, go ninjas. And then I thought, how do you top this off? And the only way I know of, from because of my Detroit, you know, from the streets.
Further.
Is you got to tell them. You got to tell them.
Isn't he Canadian?
You got to be like, go.
Go.
So you follow
I think
that
he's
up.
From Florida.
Do you know what
I'm
saying?
Miami, right?
So you're like, go ninja, go ninja, go ninja, go. And that's what I'm saying. Know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying.
Listen, word. I have to know this.
Karen. To your mother.
And then he had to explain that it was a ninja rap.
Yeah.
Carrie, are you a big enough fan that you love the Go Ninja Go Turtles movie and song? I mean, you're legit. We've discussed your legitness.
We tried to get her to quit, but she was too legit to quit.
Which is not the same.
Far too legitimate.
Yeah. You know, it is not my favorite Ninja Turtle movie, but it is definitely not the worst one.
Okay, yeah, what's the worst one?
The Turtles in Time.
Is it your favorite Ninja song?
No.
Ninja Turtle song?
No. I actually really, really like the opening theme song to the new cartoon.
Really? And how does that one go? It's like, and we're turtles, we turned into ninjas because of ooze, it's whatever.
No, but now that's my favorite Ninja Turtle song.
Hey, speaking of songs, Dakota would like to sing her movie song now. We have right. a second.
Yeah, no, I think
are
it's
you ready?
Good
wait,
time.
wait, before you sing, tell everybody hello.
Hello.
Tell everybody your name.
Dakota Grace.
Okay, now sing. Tell them what you're going to do. Say, I'm going to sing my song.
I'm going to sing my song.
Okay, are you ready to sing it?
Yeah.
Okay, 2, 3, 4.
We shall go to the movies. Always go to the movies. And come here every night and every day.
Yay!
It's a little different this week, apparently. Good
Listen,
job.
She's an artist.
It's a work in progress.
She's an artist. Hey,
look at this. I kept.
Did
this
you write that yourself?
Look at that.
Yeah.
I'm ready for my big break. I'm ready to start my own Ninja Turtle comic.
There you go. What you need is a little
See, I'm a purist. I did two toes
Thank
on the
you.
Bottom.
I appreciate
you
that.
You need to get what you got to do though is you need to get a little bit of the Zippitone or whatever it's
Zippitone.
Called. The Zippitone.
I don't even know what that means, but Carrie says it's what made me like the comic book.
It's the little black dots.
It basically the way they would shade in their comics, it's basically stickers that they would cut out and lay over the ink drawings that would give it that
oh sure
that the lines or the gradation, and it was, you know, that's part of what gave it such a unique look.
Well, sticker shading
basically.
There you go. Look, I'm adding dialogue.
Oh,
I'm building it. Nice. He says I'm going to nunchuck you.
My I'm going to be a huge Ninja Turtle.
Wait till
nerd
I give him
second.
His bro glasses.
My favorite, you know, because they couldn't have them. Like heavy swear in the black and white comics. I mean, they did swear, but you know, like they never dropped like F-bombs or anything like that. But at one point,
that was before what's his name, Sin City paved the way.
Frank Miller.
Yeah, yeah.
That's before he got real sweary.
Yeah. But in one of the old black and white comics, they were doing something and they got surprised by a bad guy, and Leonardo just yells, "Holy hippo spit!" Mm-hmm. And for some reason, that's always been my favorite swear in a comic ever, because it's so ridiculous and
Holy
silly.
Holy hippo spit.
Yeah, and it was Leonardo.
Man, he's normally pretty serious.
I know.
Yeah, he's the put together one. Yeah.
He's Mr. Serious.
He's actually really, really cool in the new cartoon. I've never liked Leonardo in any of the forms. And
now,
he's
swords, right?
Yes.
That's my favorite one.
He is very cool in this new cartoon.
Because there's swords, stick.
It's a bow staff. That's Donatello.
Stabby. And
Raphael has.
And
pizza eating.
And Michelangelo.
There's listen. Oh. There's,
listen, don't pretend there's like Michelangelo isn't the Wolverine of them.
No,
listen.
That's Raphael.
False.
What?
Everybody knows Michelangelo. Oh,
no.
Look at him.
No.
Oh,
no. I don't argue that. I will argue.
You can argue it, but you'd be wrong.
No,
she's right, dude. Everybody likes Raphael because he's the grumpy. He's kind of like Mr. Grumpy Pants. He's Mr. Grumpy Stabby.
What is that? Is that the stage show?
Did
they do a stage show?
That is the pizza.
Where's his shell?
That is the Pizza Hut.
He
doesn't
even have a shell. He's got a denim vest on.
It's the Pizza Hut coming out of your shells tour from the 80s. Hey, give it a little
early 90s, I believe.
Oh, Gearhead Supreme! He made every one of them!
All I know is Donatello was rocking a keytar a minute ago.
Oh, yeah.
We love you! One, two,
here we go.
One, two, three.
This is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. Did they put the new kids in outfits?
All right, and it's a confession time.
That's incredible. I think that one's hanging tough right now.
It is a serious confession time. I went and saw this. That's how much of a Ninja Turtle nerd I am.
It's almost impossible to remember back when that was the, like, Turtle Mania.
It was
big.
It
was
for reals.
It was for reals.
Yeah, but that was after they had niced them up a bit. That was after they had polished them.
Yeah, that was, what, early 90?
Yeah, this would have been after.
I mean, that wasn't black and white.
This would have been.
Well, yeah.
This would have been right after Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2. It was right after the Go Ninja song.
So.
Yeah. I liked how it had that, like, early Bruce Springsteen keyboard sound, and then, like, with this New Kids on the Block dancing.
Yeah. You know what I hated about it?
Everything?
Didn't have shells.
Was it everything?
Well, if I had to pick one thing.
I'm just saying, I'd rather rewatch Coming Out of Their Shells than the Michael Bay stuff, because it makes me nervous.
Well, I mean,
because
you
it
have
makes
a,
you nervous. But at least you're being honest that it makes you nervous.
It does make me
I
very
hope you love it. Maybe you'll end up loving it.
I don't even know, depending on how the previews look,
you're
I might
gonna
not
go see
no,
it.
No, I might
you
not.
You went to see Turtle New Kids.
I.
You watched the cartoon.
Yeah. I'm not ashamed of that. There's no, there. Trust me, if you're going to watch one episode and you're going to go, yeah, this is actually pretty good.
I did get into a cartoon last year. I watched that Attack on Titan. So maybe it's
good
enough.
Well, this is different.
Maybe it's good enough. I'll like it. Is it like, are the turtles ever like, blah, blah, blah? Because if so, I won't like it. Somebody hit me with a pizza.
No, it's not like
that
at
all. Or
do
they get hit on the head and make funny googly eyes and go, bunk, 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 bunk.
They do acknowledge, in the cartoon, they do acknowledge the fact that there has been other incarnations of the turtles. Like, they are, I don't want to say self-aware because I don't mean the characters are self-aware, but the cartoon itself is aware that people that are watching it have seen other incarnations. Like, at one point, one of the characters makes a joke about getting a tattoo of his face on his face, like one of those silly
and when he
things.
Imagines it in the little, like, he imagines it and it looks like the cartoon from the 80s.
Okay.
You know, so, you know, like, they're...
So the cartoon's self-aware.
Yes.
A little bit, yeah.
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 You know what I mean when I say the, like, going on thing? Like, sometimes I'm watching, like, a
perfect, you know what I mean?
Sometimes I'm watching, like, a perfectly good cartoon, and I'm like, this cartoon's really good, and then it does that, like, Last Airbender did that to me some.
Yeah, you know what? If that's what you're talking about, there is a little.
Like, they'll be like,
of that.
All of a sudden, it, like, becomes like an 8-bit cartoon. Like Aang's like, I can't. We must stop the Fire Lords or whatever.
But first,
and I'm like, really, yeah, I'm like really into this. And, like, I'm like, man, that one uncle, he seems like he could be a straight up good dude.
And
I feel bad for the brother with the scar on his face because his sister's really mean. But we go, you know, like, and I'm like, why'd you do that?
Right.
You know, all of a sudden he's like, whoa, hi! And, like, smashes into a tree and his little birds swing around.
They do just a touch of that, but they are much more careful about it in this than they were in Last Airbender.
Because, man, they take you right out of a moment.
Right.
And, like, in Last Airbender, it's like, dun, when we last left, the two fleets are about to, maybe this is the end of the water.
Right? Stop, like, making that noise.
It is, though. Like, then all of a sudden, who's the brother that can't do anything with
Sokka.
The stick? You know, and he'd be like, I was just about to do something awesome, but I spilled porridge on my feet. And you'd be like, what?
Poor Sokka.
So, anyway. And that you hear...
Porridge. They eat porridge.
I don't know that it was actually porridge. It was probably like, you know, seal skin stew or something. But that's my point.
I spilled it on the floor to Buffalo.
Yeah, and it was like, I was so into it. That's the thing is, they get the characters in that cartoon to the point where I care. And the Attack on Titan was worse because you're right in the middle of something really awesome, and then the main character just commits suicide. It's like the worst. You're like, man, this show's.
I don't need to ever watch
it. Listen, I would. When Rob and I were watching it, we'd like update each other. Attack on Titan. We'd be like, "What episode you on? I'm on this one. I want you." And I'd text him, "Wow, a whole episode without an adult breaking down in tears."
Oh yeah, dude.
They would weep. Crazy. That was a crazy show.
Yeah, dude. They would weep. It was worse. It was worse than Game of Thrones. Like the death toll on Attack on Titan is way worse. Anyway, I don't know. I'll give the Turtles a try. Hey, Slinky.
Yes, sir.
I would like to ask you for something.
I would like to oblige.
Give me some of that bean.
That pleasant, pleasant sound.
I know.
First up, Tarantino. Unchained.
He's so angry right now.
Well, last week we reported on the fact that he had written a script called The Hateful Eight, and somebody leaked it, and he was so mad, and he was like, well, I'm not going to make it then, and he stomped his feet. Well, this week that drama continues. Drama bomb.
Drama bomb.
Quentin Tarantino is now taking Gawker Media to court because their website actually posted a link to The Hateful Eight's screenplay.
And that's what Gawker does.
And that's what was leaked. And so Tarantino has filed a formal legal complaint this morning in the U.S. District Court of California and charges Gawker with copyright infringement and contributory copyright infringement.
I know six people who aren't invited to Tarantino's birthday party anymore.
Well, five, because let's face it, Michael Madsen will always be invited.
Was he one of the
six?
He
was one of the six.
Oh, see, I haven't read the six.
Six of what? What are we talking about?
Michael Madsen. I talked about this
Michael
on the
Madsen,
show.
Yeah, he doesn't listen.
Yeah, that's fair.
Michael Madsen, Michael Madsen and Tim Roth are the two actors on the list.
Oh, no way. No way did they leak it.
Right.
Uma Thurman wasn't one?
No, it was just those two.
Well, Tim
Roth. I don't think we talked in detail because I didn't know that there was never. Is,
hey.
Hey, don't even.
Do not, take his side.
Wait a minute, guys. I spilled porridge on my feet. That's how I'm going to diffuse everything between you guys from now on, is as soon as things get really serious. Hey, look, I don't think that you should say that. I'm all of a sudden it's going to go, boy, oi, going. Or, So here's the deal, Ken Dog. Tarantino wrote a Western.
Called The Hateful Eight.
Called The Hateful Eight.
Yeah.
And he only showed it to six of his closest friends.
And we talked about that?
And yes. One of them leaked
on this show.
Yes.
When?
Last week.
Anyway, one of them leaked.
Now, you weren't here last week.
No,
so
I wasn't here.
You can pipe down. Do you remember that happening last week?
The problem is I read about it. Talking about it.
Okay, go ahead.
All I'm saying is we talked about it on our last show, and it happened
about it
the
again.
Day before yesterday.
Jerk.
Well, here's the funniest thing is that we've got a friend.
I think everybody in this room read it but me, and that's where...
Yeah, it happened that, yeah. It happened like Friday, I think.
Okay. No one sent me...
So it wasn't on the show.
Here's the deal. Is one of the best things that happened is... We had a friend who was in a restaurant when this went down. And we've got a friend named Jordan Duke who has gone out and is now a screenplay reader for some sort of big film company. And he's out there and he reads scripts all day and decides which ones get passed on up and which ones don't. And he was in a restaurant while Tarantino was going berserk.
In that restaurant?
Yeah, in fact, this was before the story break. He had posted to his Facebook page, in a restaurant, watching Tarantino. I think he's mad because a script leaked. Or
it's a birthday party.
Or it's a birthday party.
He
couldn't
figure out. He said he's on a date. I can't tell if he's on a date at a birthday party or really angry that someone has leaked his script. And the funny thing is, somebody really did leak his script. So apparently Tarantino was not
He was on a birthday date.
Maybe.
Evidently.
I don't know.
I don't know.
He's mad, and he said he'll never make the movie now.
Yeah.
And so he gave this script to six people.
and somebody leaked it.
I just love the maturity of the whole thing. Oh, people, you didn't, you shared it? Well, that, psh, I ain't making it then. I'm not gonna,
and do
I'm
you know the six people it. Were Tim Roth, Uma Thurman, Mike Madsen?
No, it was Tim Roth and Michael Madsen, and then the other four were like were agent type people.
Yeah, but everybody was close to him, right?
Yeah,
like,
they
no,
were all
like,
very
these are
close
all people,
people
that were like really good friends of his. So somebody has shanked this dude.
Right.
I mean, you know, we can make fun
somebody
of him.
Somebody shanked this guy, or somebody's housekeeper picked up a script, or somebody's pool boy found
and there's
it.
Two
or
people,
what?
And there was two people on the list that he had said
can none of them
only read it and did not leave with a copy. They sat in a
they
room
sat
and read
there
it.
With him
and he,
read it.
Yeah. So it's one of it's really
so it's
only
one of
four
people,
but he didn't say who it was. So apparently though Gawker.
I don't know, but I'm mad that I don't get to see Tim Roth and Mike Madsen in a really awesome Tarantino Western.
Yeah.
I like Tim
I think
Roth.
You already did.
No, I didn't.
It was called Reservoir Dogs.
Nope, that wasn't a Western.
Kinda.
Nope, heist movie.
If you think about it.
Heist movie.
But.
Still a heist movie.
If.
Indeed a heist movie.
When you.
A heist movie.
The part where.
Heist movie.
There's a guy. And there's
yeah.
a fire.
Okay, that part's Western.
Yeah, no, that's Western. You're right, that's Western.
Yeah, that all right, I rest my case.
Kenny's like, what about the part where they rode in on a horse and said, bring me the sheriff?
No.
Wait a minute! It was a Western! Anyway, what's next?
I keep coming back because I'm so... The Haunted House 2 back to April 18th. Open Road Films has bumped up David Ayer's new action film, Sabotage, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. They've moved it to March 28th. Historically, that March slot's been always occupied by an action entry. Last year, it was G.I. Joe Retaliation, bringing in $40.5 million, which is a pretty big bow for March. But that's a pretty high bar for a movie like Sabotage with Arnold Schwarzenegger when you consider his last few action films were Escape Plan and The Last
He's
Stand,
done.
And neither of them did well.
He's done. It's not going to happen.
I'm going to tell you something. I saw The Last Stand on Netflix the other day.
I almost watched
it. Is it on Netflix now?
It is.
I'm going to watch
it. I almost watched it, but I watched Blackfish instead.
Well, you want to know what I thought?
Yeah, I really do.
I thought it was a ridiculous 1980s commando type Schwarzenegger film.
So you're saying it was good?
I'm saying I loved it.
Was there a montage where he geared up?
Yeah.
Yes! Yes!
I'm also saying...
I love early 90s gear up.
I'm also saying it was terrible.
Yeah, yeah.
Johnny Knoxville's in that, right?
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. And so is Luis Guzman.
So what made this any different?
Luis Guzman, the you know, of course, the most famous graduate of Greendale Community College.
That is true.
I love that guy. That dude's funny.
It is funny. What's really funny is that dude can't move. And so he's like getting shot at, and he's trying to pretend like he's being quick and getting out of the way. But he's like all gut, and it won't get out of his way.
I fail to see how this is any different than the one that The Rock made. Remember the one that The Rock made where he played the sheriff and the... Isn't it like the same... Johnny Knoxville was in there?
You mean Walking Tall.
Walking Tall.
Yeah.
And
there's
the
an
last
there's
thing.
An
no he's already the sheriff in
he's this. Already the sheriff in this one, but he's got to go to town against a there is a there's two bad guy, kind of bad guys,
a smuggling cartel.
One
right?
is a smuggling is a well, it's actually they're trying to get this criminal a Mexican drug lord or something. They're trying mafia lord. They're trying to get him across the border. They break him out of jail at the beginning, and they're trying to get him across the border. But then there's also an angry black FBI guy trying to catch the mafia guy that's escaped.
Oh, sure.
Who doesn't who thinks of Schwarzenegger as some stupid small town sheriff?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
But he doesn't realize that Schwarzenegger was like paramilitary Green Beret guy in his youth.
Which is true. He was commando in his youth.
There is this really...
I don't need to know if he wore underwear.
There is this really ridiculous...
See, the show just went...
But you know, like all good Schwarzenegger films, after everything gets blown up and everything is, you know, all the car chases and all the action and stuff, it boils down to Schwarzenegger and this Mexican guy on a bridge.
Sure.
One, in the middle of the bridge. On one side is Mexico. Yeah. And the other side is Schwarzenegger's town. And they just have to go to fisticuffs.
Yeah.
And, I'm okay with that. And don't spoil it.
Wait, there's
he
this,
throws them off the
I gotta
bridge.
Tell you, there's this great moment. There's this great moment, though, where Schwarzenegger actually tells him, you give immigrants like me a bad name.
Yes! That's good, dude. That made everybody on the right happy.
I know. So
look at that. It's true. It's absolutely true.
I'll tell you what.
That's what happened.
I'll tell you what
that's
went
my
through
right,
my mind.
That's my right-wing Republican.
My mind went, has Obama seen this film?
Well, look, dude, there is, you should watch it because there is a car chase through a cornfield at the end of this movie. It's a cornfield, you know, apparently on the Mexican border. I don't know.
South
don't
Texas
ask questions.
It happens.
Don't ask questions. But it's awesome.
The bad immigrants are trying to take our corn. But the good immigrants, they're going to put it on a stick, roast it, put mayonnaise on it. Like Arnold.
Them fellers.
He's not trying to steal our corn. He came here and went through the classes and speaks English.
Them fellers is just going to make tortillas.
Which is fine if they're chips.
Anyway, like for real, like it's terrible. It's awesome.
I'll check it out for sure.
Schwarzenegger just—I haven't had a chance to watch it yet. They did.
It was on the list, dude. It was Last Stand. Here were my choices: yeah. Captain Phillips,
right? Because that just came out on there
and
on Netflix.
Yeah,
it was Captain Phillips.
Yeah,
Elysium, The Last Stand, or Blackfish, and I watched Blackfish.
I should not have gone to the Red Box Friday because I could have watched
it. There's a few. Skyfall is on there now.
Skyfall.
Yeah, I saw that.
And there's another
Elysium,
one
we said that one.
Elysium.
There was another
good.
One. Oh,
I
you know
Elysium.
The other one that hadn't been on there? I don't know why it was on there sooner, but it was the Denzel Washington flight movie. That one just came out.
Yeah, I watched that a couple weeks ago.
I want to see it.
It's good.
I want to see it.
It's uncomfortable.
Yeah, Mike was shaking her head. She's like, nope. Didn't like that. Didn't care for that.
Well, no, I won't watch
their movies about flight.
No, but
what, a black man can't be a pilot?
What?
No, you were in the bathroom. You're when the kind of joke earlier. It's cool.
You're the kind of person.
Hey, use your Arnold voice and intervene here about him giving bad pilots a bad name. Come on, man. Do me a favor. I'm not good at that voice.
It's not like Mary Juice is chill. Okay.
Thanks, man. I need you to step in, Arnold.
Pops, we should put some distance between us.
He did a thing with Gold's Gym where he dressed up in
goofy outfits.
And pretended like he wasn't himself and was like a trainer. I haven't watched it yet, but it should
he
be
was
pretty
like,
entertaining.
So he's like
you
in
need
this, like,
to lift more.
He walks up and he's in these like giant like Salvador Dali mustaches.
Yes.
And he's like, no, really, because you know I'm not Arnold Schwarzenegger.
No, I get that a lot.
Oh my.
And what's next?
Yeah, it's next.
Coverage overkill.
Yes, it is.
So I thought I'd just
Empire Magazine is doing, get this, 25 variant covers for their March 2014 edition. Celebrating 25 years of Empire Magazine, and therefore all 25 covers are of X-Men Days of Future Past, each one featuring one hero. And one of them features the director, Bryan Singer. And if you put all 25 of these magazine covers together, left to right, they form a giant panorama of X-Men people standing in front of the White House.
Now, here's my question. Are these the pictures everybody's been getting so angry about?
Yeah, what we were just looking at
those
is
are
where
them.
That's from.
Yeah, this is what has made everybody mad about Quicksilver.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Hey,
I'm not buying 25.
No. Me neither.
It's I don't read Empire Magazine. Who am I kidding?
I don't even know what Empire Magazine
Sorry.
Is.
It's a movie magazine.
It's a movie magazine. Right. It's
I
not
think
bad.
You're supposed
it's
to get bad. Together with your friends, have a movie party, everybody brings their copy.
And then
and
you put them together.
You have 25.
Yeah, you put it,
like
a,
I wish I had 25
like
friends
a,
that were nerdy enough to all subscribe
like
to Empire.
Piece,
I wish
puzzle.
I had 25 friends.
Man, I wish I had money to subscribe to Empire.
I wish I could go to the movies.
I heard that. What else?
I spilled this porridge on my shoes. Now it's taking on a southern draw.
Super Bowl of Hollywood. This year,
I'm glad it had an intro theme song.
The films that have been confirmed to have Super Bowl spots during the big game on February 2nd are Draft Day, The Amazing Spider-Man 2, Captain America, the Winter Soldier, and we'll get our first look at Transformers Age of Extinction. They had said we would also see another movie, Guardians of the Galaxy, but the guy who directed Guardians of the Galaxy has said that there is not a Super Bowl commercial for Guardians of the Galaxy, but there is something cooler, but we don't know what that means.
I don't think that's a thing.
Maybe Rocket Raccoon will be performing live with Britney Spears during
and
the
halftime
show.
And there's going to be a nip slip.
You never know. How many nips does Rocket Raccoon have?
That's true.
Six.
There could be six.
Ryan, with no hesitation.
Six.
With all. Well, the six. Raccoon is a nocturnal animal that has six nipples.
Hey, I have a question about the Transformers movie. It's called Age of Extinction. Mm-hmm. Does that mean there's Dinobots?
Yes,
in
it does.
Okay.
That's yeah, there are Dinobots.
Exciting. That's kind of exciting.
Even though this is the man who ruined your turtles?
It's the man who ruined my Transformers, too. But it's still cool to hear.
I like Dinobots.
Me, Grimlock, yeah, say.
He's my favorite of all time.
Yeah.
Yeah, Grimlock.
Not because of any other thing. I remember there was this kid in grade school who had them all. We didn't have any. We had a couple GoBots.
Yeah,
but I wasn't high class like this kid. This dude had all the Transformers.
GoBots were like the cheap Hot Wheels version. Yeah.
And he would bring them to school and we'd play with them on the playground. Grimlock was my jam.
Transformers were like, do you remember how great it felt to hold just to hold a Transformer?
They were heavy.
Just to be like,
yeah, metal.
This is a thing.
Yeah,
and the
Kenny
new
and
ones,
I had
they
GoBots.
Don't do. They can't.
I had a bunch of the mini Transformers.
Do you know what the best part about a Transformer was?
The little hologram?
The fact that no matter what, my mom couldn't make it into a car, but I could.
Yeah.
That was the coolest part.
Success, mother.
Dude, I remember seeing a kid that had Starscream and being
Starscream
like...
Starscream was so
and
cool.
Be like,
that's
like
a decent sized plane.
It's like the coolest thing I've ever seen. It looked gigantic. And I was like, when did they start making toys like this? Because Kenny and I had sticks.
Well, you want me to? I'm about to make you sad because of the Michael Bay Transformers thing. They've decided that fans of the new Transformers movies, the kids who are watching these movies, want satisfaction and gratification from their toys faster, and so they are completely redesigning the toy line so that they will all transform with like the push of a button or the flick of your single wrist.
A lot of them are already like that. Like, yeah. Axel's got a couple
the rescue bots were like that.
And I saw another kid had.
But it's okay for the rescue bots to be like that. They're made for 4-year-olds.
Because they're made for 4-year-olds.
Well, yeah. But even with the other movies that have come out, they're not like they were. Yeah. Like they're super expensive, it seems like, mm-hmm. Which is why we only had GoBots. Because if they cost what the transforming Bumblebee cost back then, no wonder my dad was like,
well,
No. I
remember when I was a kid, Optimus Prime was $50.
Was he?
Yeah.
See, I don't remember that.
I mean, and that's like, you know, even today, that's like crazy expensive toy.
I can remember Transformers and Star Wars stuff. I remember saving my money to get the $100 needed to get the Millennium Falcon that had the top that pulled off of it. And I never did save enough to get the Death Star. At some point I got the Death Star and the Ewok Village from my grandma going to a yard sale.
Right.
You know what I mean? But like those were expensive. Yeah, that's $100 back then.
Right.
Like, can you imagine? I mean, good grief.
Well, the AT-AT Walker's $160 now.
I didn't even know that they were still selling.
And that was $100 when I was a kid.
Yeah.
So
there you go. I don't know. But Transformers were awesome toys. They were awesome. Awesome toys, and so were the G.I. Joe vehicles.
I've still got one. Listen, here's a funny story.
G.I. Joe vehicles are awesome.
I don't know if you remember this.
I don't know if you have funny stories.
We'll find out. Well,
both of these things are fair because we don't remember.
You don't.
And you don't.
I don't know if you.
You know, like maybe you should be telling the story.
There was this birthday I had when I got one of the larger G.I. Joe vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
And it was the toy that Rob wanted really, really.
It was called the Wolverine. It had rocket launchers on it. And it was like a tank, but with like multiple rocket launchers.
And so I get it. I open it up, and the look on Rob's face. Now, it wasn't like from my mom or my grandma that lived close. It was like from like an aunt or somebody.
It was from someone who probably didn't know how badly he wanted it.
Correct. And so I opened this thing up, and I'm like, sweet. And his face was just the utter sadness. See, because the grandma that lived close was the type of grandma who would like bring you your birthday present and give your sibling a little something too.
Yeah,
right,
yeah.
Right.
But I open up the Wolverine, and I mean, it was one of the nicest G.I. Joe, you know, like we had that. We had the Millennium Falcon. We had an X-Wing. It was kind of on that scale, but for G.I. Joe, you know what I mean? And his face, and he was like, that's the one I really, really wanted. And I was like, and I got it.
I was super bummed about it.
I'm pretty sure I still have it.
I was really bummed about it because I had made very clear to the world. It wasn't like we were old enough for me to get it then, and I tried to handle it with as much grace as I could. But the issue was that,
not
like,
successfully.
I tried. You have to understand, dude, my heart was broken. Like, it was not a cheap toy.
No.
And it came with an action figure.
Yeah.
And it had rockets. You know what I mean? Like, this was a big deal. It was a tank with rocket launchers on it. And I wanted it really bad, and you got it. And it wasn't, and I didn't want to be like Nancy Sad Pants about it. But the fact is, I had made everyone really aware. Like, this is the toy I want.
It's not like
this is the toy
nobody got it. It's like, it's in my house, but that ain't mine.
Right, and it's the one, and it's the, I was so specific about it.
But I'm sure you shared it.
Oh, I share like a mug.
Yeah, no, I mean, we played together.
But
our toys all went into one big toy box,
right,
if I recall.
But we still had those times where it was like, no, get out of my room. No, that's mine. You know what I mean? Because we were close enough in age.
Yeah, we like to play. I mean, we like to play
with
toys.
Yeah, but all siblings have that.
Yeah.
But sometimes you just have to throw down and go, no, the Wolverine is mine.
Yeah. Now, I think I still have one.
Really?
I have that. I have...
I'm still sad in my heart, then.
Who's the dude? Who's the dude with the hat?
It's what you're getting for your birthday.
That guy was my number one guy, Flint.
Yeah, I've got Flint. I might have a Flint that has his rubber band snapped and is like, so he's like a pelvis, a set of legs and a torso with
arms.
I
liked Flint because he had like the coolest thing about G.I. Joe's is we had had Star Wars figures for so long that when G.I. Joe's came out, like the articulation and the detail in a G.I.
Mind-blowing.
Joe was like, I can't even deal with this right now. Like, you just want to, as a little kid, you
but
just want to
But if you get overloaded, that rubber band goes, you're done.
Right.
Oh yeah, dude. So I've got like 5 or 6 Joes. I've got the Wolverine, and I've got some. Get this, I've got some guns.
Oh really? Just like a little Ziploc bag full of.
They're like
he doesn't mean biceps.
And so I mean, but you know how hard those are to still even exist.
Yeah.
They're either in a landfill, they came out in your dog's poo, or they're in your mom's vacuum.
Yeah. Well, here's the fact, dude. I'll tell you. Here you go. You ready? I have Cobra Commander.
Really?
I do. I have a Cobra Commander. All I got.
I've got the good Joe.
That's
You've
all
got
I got.
The Cobra Commander. Storm Shadow.
Yes.
Yeah, but they got him cuffed because your boy Cobra Commander sent him on a mission, and the Joes caught him. Sorry.
Dude, that's how it is. I loved it. Did you even like G.I. Joe?
I did not.
I think
you were
I
just
Snake
what?
Eyes.
Just Star Wars?
Oh, my God.
Star Wars and Transformers.
Snake Eyes was the coolest.
Yeah, if you had Snake Eyes, then you were blessed.
I had him at one point. I'm not sure if I still have him. I'm going to go home. I'm going to go home, and I'm going to send you pictures of it, and hopefully
I'll
get
my heart
some sad-faced emoticons back.
So
I'm going to send you the ones that look like they're trying not to cry but still have tears.
Good for you, buddy.
I'm like, I'm so glad that you have it. You know, it's a tank with rocket launchers.
Now, the rocket launchers are missing, but, like, the swivels are still there.
Yeah, well, you broke my heart.
Sorry, bro.
And the Wolverine, apparently.
Well.
Same.
I don't think this was my original Wolverine. I reacquired it from someone.
Sure, yeah.
I don't know, dude. I'd go buy one just to say that I finally got one.
When Axel sees it, he always goes, I really want to play with that. And I go, no.
I would get one just to say that I finally got one, except that the issue would be like, it didn't come from my grandma. Like, my grandma still got it wrong. Sent it to the wrong kid.
Well, you know? I don't think if it came from dad's folks, they didn't get it wrong because I was their favorite.
Oh! That's also true. That's also true.
Man.
There's no getting around that. So now I blame them personally.
Hey, this movie's in that Tarantino Western.
Listen to Lights, Camera, Cleveland. We'll be right back.
Did you say it's a film? Tonight.
It's a heist film.
I got the feeling that something ain't right. I'm so scared in case I fall off my chair. And I'm wondering how I'll get down the stairs. Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Yes, I'm stuck in the middle with you. And I'm wondering what it is I should do. It's so hard to keep the smile from my face. Losing control, yeah, I'm all over the place. Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right, here I am, stuck in the middle with you. When you started out with nothing and you found that you're a sorry man, and your fans, they all come calling, slap you on the back and say,
being back is camera. That we're back, and I'm talking
Cleveland.
We're talking
so
at
many
the same time.
Thing that we did.
I love it.
I spilled some porridge on my feet.
What?
We're back.
Do you know, because maybe there's things that you should do.
Wow.
We'll be back. Try listening to Ice Camera Cleveland.
I like it.
I think I'm going to watch that movie tonight.
It's because he's doing an impersonation of...
It's an impersonation of Conan O'Brien doing his impersonation of Schwarzenegger. Arnold. So that's why that's funny.
That's what my Jimmy Stewart is. My Jimmy Stewart is Dana Carvey doing Jimmy Stewart.
Sometimes, though, that's how you've got to roll.
You don't have a choice.
Well, some people just nail it so well. You can't. You have to go with,
yeah,
you know.
Oh, sure.
Well, I mean,
sure.
Look at the whole Tina Fey thing that happened with Sarah Palin. Oh, like, more people knew Sarah Palin
right.
as Tina Fey yes. than they did actually knowing who yeah. Sarah Palin was.
You know, can we give
Which
a
really
shout
is
out?
A
you
sad know, state of affairs.
You know, we do this. We try to do this when we can. We shout out to, like, Travis Beecham.
Sure.
We've shouted out to J. Roddy Walston. You know, people from
And
Cleveland,
his business.
And his business. We try to shout out when there are, like, local hometown
that
people that go and do good things.
Sure.
But have we talked at all about Tyler Langford?
on the show. I thought maybe you guys would. You know, for those of you who don't know,
we haven't yet.
Tyler Langford was the big, huge, happy barista here at the Starbucks. He was,
right.
He graduated from Lee and super nice guy. And he was always making people smile and laugh and kept saying he wanted to go to Chicago to pursue his dream of being on Saturday Night Live.
Right. He was going to go to Second City, right?
Yeah, and he is now. He's not part of Second City proper, but apparently Second City has, and Ryan, you'd know way more about this than I would. They've got like other little underclass.
Yes.
Like you can be on Second City, which is like the thing to be on.
Right.
Or you can be like every Monday night. They've got its own name. Like, several, you know, like, troops, yeah. like Laugh Factory.
Right.
Or, you know, like the ha-ha players or whatever. So anyway, guys, they go to Chicago, and the ones that are decent, I guess, get picked for these other Second City side projects, and you do good with those, and then you end up on the thing. But I did think because he was always so nice to us, we ought to shout out to people on the show that if you haven't seen him on the YouTube, he's been blowing up this last month, and he had already kind of become internet famous on Reddit because he was the big fat guy that sneezed at a wedding. Do you remember that? And it had made it on like Reddit's top 10 images of 2013 or something. Like, right. He went to this beautiful wedding where he was asked to be in the wedding party, and right when they were snapping like the photo, he had a legitimate sneeze. Now this guy is like 6'4", 375 pounds with an afro.
If there were a thicker, larger man than you in town.
He's that guy. He's bigger than me. And so in this wedding photo, there's like this beautiful petite little bride and groom, and he towers over them like a giant in full sneeze, like with his cheeks puffed out. And it looks ridiculous. So that kind of is what got him into Second City.
Or
I guess.
Does it look awesome?
It does look awesome.
Well, I mean, he had that video of the cold on his way to work.
Yes.
That thing killed me.
Listen, so many people. I didn't. You know what the thing was? I actually, and I told him this because he and I are friends.
You've seen it?
I told him that the first time I saw it, I didn't think it was as funny. In fact, you guys had Dan Buck on the show, and I said, I feel like my Facebook thread, my Facebook page is telling me I'm a sinner if I don't think Tyler Langford is like the funniest thing since Steve Martin, because people were just going crazy. The thing was like getting like hundreds and hundreds of thousands of views.
Right.
And then, I don't know, man, like about the third or fourth time that I watched it, it really, when he gets to the part about screaming Satan,
I'm done, dude. When he gets to there, I'm just losing it.
Or when he's in the elevator and he says, I'll just stay here, or I'll live here. And then the next thing you hear is him screaming, "What do you mean I can't live here?"
And when he says, people ask what it feels like, and he says, "Imagine what does the cold feel like? Imagine Christmas." And both of your parents have just lost their jobs.
So anyway, it was picked up. Huffington Post ran it. NBC ran it. CBS ran it. So I want to give him a shout out. And the reason he's on my mind is he released another video today. So for those of you out there that haven't yet seen it, he released a video today where he's in downtown Chicago with a Southerner's translation of the graffiti. And so he's interpreting all of the graffiti, and it was really fun. I thought it was even funnier.
Put it on our Facebook page.
Yeah.
If you want to see it, Rob will stick it up there. It's facebook.com/lightscameracleveland.
So I thought we'd give him a shout out because I like it when local boy does good.
I'd like to see that guy get on the SNL.
I think he could. You know what the funny thing is? He could be Horatio Sands or, you know, dude. I don't know why his name's forgetting me.
Who are you talking about?
Yeah, right? Whatever. Chris Farley. Took me a minute. It took me. Anyway, they need a big fat guy.
They've got one.
Yeah, they have a. What is his name?
They have the guy who does Drunk Uncle.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, when he goes.
Bobby Moynihan.
Bobby
right?
Moynihan. Yeah.
That dude's funny.
Yes, he is.
Well, I mean.
Drunk Uncle's hit or miss, but when it's funny, it's really funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he has other stuff that he does that's funny, I think.
Yes, he does.
Yeah.
So, yes, anyway.
He does. Have you seen his Chris Christie?
I haven't yet.
He does.
I bet it's good.
Dude, the other night he was doing Chris Christie on, like, being interviewed on, like, a MSNBC or something. And and they were like, tell us, Governor Christie, how are you feeling now as people are starting to ask you all these questions about the, what is it, Bridgegate, they're calling it, you know, where he'd supposedly messed with the toll booths to make people, you know. And they were like, how are you feeling with people asking you those questions? And he goes, well, let me ask you this. How long does it take you to get to work? And he was like, oh, it's about 15 minutes. Yeah. Well, let's say you ask me that question again, but this time you consider, what if something were to happen to that commute?
That's funny. I got to see it. I haven't seen him. But I don't know. I hope Tyler Wingford becomes the fat guy.
Yeah, it'd be cool.
I hope the current fat guy gets a movie deal and leaves.
There you go. Yeah. Let's let everyone become more successful.
Yeah, I'm fine with
this
it.
This one time, everyone's happy.
Yeah. Aww. So there you go.
It's like,
I don't know.
It's like AMC Mike's Bible World.
Yeah, I'm for it.
Everybody lives happily ever after.
I like it. Hold on.
I need to hit some.
In all fairness, wait a minute. I spilled porridge on my shoes.
Wanting everyone to be happy. What's wrong with me?
Tomorrow, maybe we should do another segment.
Yeah, let's do this. Let's do. Do we want to do five questions or what else?
You guys ready for five questions?
Not really.
What were other options?
You've got a bunch. You can do them. Yes, we're ready.
We do carrot cake.
Okay, well, we'll do five questions and then we'll do carrot cake. Ken Dog says he's ready. So, Anchorman 2.
Five questions about the Anchorman dose.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to start out with the downer. This one's for Rob.
Number one.
Guy who works with me, he went and saw this, and he said there was a suicide joke. That he's so upset he tries to hang himself in his dressing room.
Yeah.
You're giggling. How did they make that funny? Because just kind of to hear the situation, I was kind of like, okay, sure, but bottom line is they're making a suicide joke. That is a tough sell.
Not when it's Ron Burgundy. I don't know how to explain. If you saw the film.
Can I help?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, you
can. The joke is not in the attempt. It's in his cover-up.
Yeah, and it's in his absolute failure to... Like, you never for it. Like, let me just say, like, no. Like, I'm not going to worry about spoilering this.
As you watch, it's in the first 10 minutes.
Yeah,
of the movie.
Like,
as you watch him set it up, there is no doubt
there's no doubt he's going to fail.
Well, right. But I'm just saying to make light of.
You know, one of my. Tragedy. Let me say this. Like,
funny that he says to make light because he's kind of making a pun and not realizing.
One of the right, yeah, yeah. He's trying to hang himself from a hanging light.
Like, it's a it's a fluorescent light on the
that's hanging on the
itty bitty chains. So there's, I mean, you know, so he throws this rope over it,
and he's talking to his dog,
Baxter.
Baxter, I'm sorry. Go on without me.
Okay. Woof. All right, question number two.
Well, hold on. On that. Because they've made an entire movie based off of someone trying to commit suicide, Better Off Dead. So, I mean...
Yeah.
I mean, that's, you know, and that was a really funny
movie. It just wasn't dark, dude.
Okay.
It's not dark. It's not a dark movie.
The joke is that when the guy walks in to see what just happened, his cover-up is to tell the truth.
Right.
In a way that sounds like a question. Right. And so he goes, I was... trying to kill myself?
Right.
And it is kind of funny.
So clearly, as you two talk about it and laugh, they do it well.
I wouldn't say that. I wouldn't go that far.
You know what? I want to say this, though. What I'm realizing is that as I remember it and discuss it, it's way funnier than it was when we watched it.
Yeah,
and you know,
we had that conversation.
We said, what if this is like the first one, where the first time you watched it, it wasn't quite so funny, and later you were going to laugh. And I'm a little worried that maybe that's going to happen.
I think it's going to start happening with these questions. All right, this next one's for Ryan. Other than Ron Burgundy, who was your favorite?
Oh.
I mean, you've got.
That's easy.
You've got Champ. You've got Brick.
You know,
you've got Brick Paul Rudd
is,
guy.
Brick is given. First of all, Paul Rudd is terrible this time.
What's his?
Really?
What's that guy's name?
Paul. He is.
Champ Brick. Isn't he Paul?
No, he's.
He goes by a name though. He doesn't go by a.
Give me a minute. I'll remember.
Okay. Anyway.
Who's your favorite?
Yeah.
I've got to say, though, Brick is given an opportunity to shine in this movie. He has his own subplot in which he falls in love with the girl.
Oh, my God.
He meets a girl and falls in love. And you know, she is a
girl played by Kristen Wiig.
And
brilliantly played
by Kristen. She is a close second as far as who steals this movie. It's the two of them.
Getting into hot sauce.
Hey. No.
I'm just giving you guys a heads up.
Thank you. No, coffee stirs.
Okay.
Anyway, all right,
we've got a 4-year old.
Yeah, here's the thing. Here's the thing, Ken, is that it's really hard to like anyone other than Brick.
Because they're all bad
when you
people.
You say other than Ron right. Burgundy, who's your favorite, is that this is the truth.
Brian Fantana.
Here's the deal is that Champ phones this movie in.
Yeah.
In the worst way possible. He could have almost not even been in the movie.
And Paul Rudd is
Paul
cursed
Rudd has
by
gone
being
beyond
too
it now. Like the problem is once you've seen This Is 40, and you learn that like Paul Rudd knows how to act. The problem is you have these like you have Brick, Champ, and Ron Burgundy, and then nuanced Paul Rudd, the movie star. And
right.
It's not that he doesn't try; like you can tell he's trying.
But he's got a dumbed
it's
down a
too
performance.
Poignant.
And
yeah,
he
it's
can't
almost
do
too
it.
Poignant.
Right.
There's some moments when he actually. There's a moment when he looks at Ron and he goes. He says something like, "You know, sorry, Ron. You know, we'd always be your friends forever." Except it's a real performance. It's
right.
not. It's not actual. So you're kind of mad at Paul Rudd for becoming. Because
it's
actor.
Like that could have maybe been a funny line if you had not delivered it well.
And then right. the problem with Champ is that Champ
awful.
Has gone the other way, and I'm beginning to wonder if he,
like Champ, says his lines and then like turns off.
They're
and just
horrible.
Stands there. And then when it's time for his line again, he explodes and does the line and then turns off again.
He literally does. He literally does this one line
that guy's name,
where he says something like he says something like, "So Ron, how you been? No, really, man, how you been?" And he like delivers the line just like that. And you're like, "No, dude, you were really funny and crass before."
Right. What happened?
But Steve Carell shows that he's still got the actual chops. It's
right.
not just that it's written well.
Right.
It's that he is funny.
Right.
He's funny as he delivers it.
And
he
and Kristen,
stays funny.
And Kristen Wiig and he have a strange chemistry that
they
really works.
They could make a movie. They could make a movie.
Haven't
they
already
could do a brick,
or have they not?
I don't know, but they could do a Brick. They could do a Brick Tamlin movie.
They really could. It
yeah.
was good.
Yeah, it was fantastic. But and you know here's what's weird to me though is that in this whole film, like the you know how like when you see a sequel and it's been a long time since the first one, you know, when you see like
how
your favorite
how are these?
And it's been a few. I mean, it's been 6 years.
Enough that Ron Burgundy looks really old.
Yeah. But like there's a
and
there's,
they play on that?
Well, it takes
a
place
little,
further
a little,
in the future.
Yeah.
But you know, there's when stuff like that happens, there's those moments when you see like a character for the first time in the movie, and like inside you go, oh yeah, they're back, you know,
yeah.
or whatever. And what was strange to me was the only time I actually got that feeling was like almost at the end of the movie when Vince Vaughn appears playing Wes Mantooth.
It was awesome.
He takes off this helmet and it's Wes Mantooth, and like the whole theater kind of went, yes.
Yeah.
Wes Mantooth.
I don't remember him.
And then he rolls out, and the first line he has is about his mother, and it's like, yes.
He's the one that
he's the rival news
reporter. Reporters
from News Channel 9.
I mean, I remember
Wes
Mantooth
from News Channel 9.
Who was the guy?
Dorothy Mantooth is
a saint.
Who was the guy who was like?
All right, but not the face. Oh yeah, no, clearly not the face.
Oh, that was Ben. That was Ben Stiller.
That was Ben Stiller.
Ben Stiller.
Because they all, yeah. But
all right, there were the weirdest cameos.
Yeah, it was,
dude. The weird during the big fight scene.
Harrison Ford, Will Smith. Although Harrison Ford's a little bigger than a cameo.
Will Smith, Kanye West.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Kanye West at one point is like, "Don't forget MTV."
Right.
You're like, what? Yeah, Liam Neeson. On behalf of the History Channel?
So strange. John C. Reilly playing the ghost
of Andrew Jackson.
So is there another
gosh, here
battle?
We are laughing about it now.
But it wasn't funny
Man.
When we saw it.
Is there another?
Yeah, there is another battle.
All right. That's cool.
Question three.
Question three.
Is this set up for a third?
as much as the first one was.
Okay. Well, yeah. Are we thinking like in 10 years?
I honestly hope they don't do one.
Or if
we're
they,
laughing about it now, except for it was a little painful.
If they
all
do,
right, that leads me into my next question.
If they do a
four.
Third one, though, they need to wait a few years and then come out and make it a total full on drama like Hangover 3. What?
What?
No.
What's your question?
Question four.
How close do they flirt with the grown ups line? With the, this is it for us, guys. We're not going to be. I mean, because.
Oh, no, we discussed that. It's bad. It's really bad, man. Like when we walked out, I think we were in agreement. We've laughed more now than we laughed in the movie theater.
Which may make a second viewing more funny.
Maybe.
I mean, maybe.
But the
so
fact
this is like
is,
a Zoolander?
When we walked maybe. Out, when we walked out of it,
easy,
my
maybe.
biggest worry was, has Will Ferrell pulled a Adam Sandler?
Right.
Honest, is he done? Like the edge wasn't there for him. That's right. What I say. Like Brick was so much funnier, and Steve Carell was so much funnier as the character.
Right.
That really, like Ron Burgundy, comes off as really
just a jerk,
unlikable, as opposed to like in the first movie, he's
kind
he's
of dumb,
like,
and so
dumb and hapless. In this movie, he's making awful decisions
because he's a jerk.
Because he's a jerk, and right. So it didn't really. It wasn't as. Wasn't yeah. as good.
Question five.
Do they have to use a lot of vulgarity to save jokes, or are the vulgar jokes funny because they're funny?
Or
do they try to push it?
I don't
it didn't
even
strike
remember
me as
much,
vulgar.
Yeah,
it didn't
no?
strike me as a vulgar
I don't remember
movie.
Much vulgarity at
he
all.
He had like things he said like, by Zeus's nipples.
Right.
Right, but
you know,
it wasn't
kind of
like
thing, but there, it wasn't
super
really
full on
humor.
No, I mean there was
all right.
I don't recall anything that like was really like, oh my gosh, I can't believe they just said that.
Well, I think I'll definitely look for it on DVD.
Yeah.
Yeah, you might be able to Netflix it soon.
Mm. Yeah.
Stuff's coming to Netflix quicker than it used to.
Yeah. Netflix is working on it.
Yeah.
Or do you think okay. that Captain Phillips is just trying to get more pumped up for their Oscars?
I think that's true also.
The Somali pirate guy.
Maybe.
I also think that's true.
Hard telling.
Maybe in a meta cup.
I think we'll be right back.
Lights, camera, Cleveland.
There's nothing wrong with this.
No. There's a lot.
I have a list.
They're talking about Afternoon Delight.
We'll be right. It's really funny for this song to be playing as I watch Dakota crying, weeping in the corner.
I mean, it's funny.
Yeah, funny. And we're back. We're so back. We're so back.
We are back.
That could be the...
I think Dakota has decided...
She's gripping my leg Dakota's, like it's a horse.
Dakota is more comfortable in the studio than I think anyone ever guessed her being.
Welcome back to Lights, Camera, Cleveland on Whoop FM 99.9. You can find us at lightscameracleveland.com, facebook.com/lightscameracleveland, or on the Twitters.
At lightscamcleve.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
At lightscamcleve.
I am still not able to get onto the blue chat.
So I don't think I've ever seen her go from happy to sad more times than I've seen it during this particular...
It's a phase.
This particular
it's a phase.
Show.
Well, it's okay. Yeah. It can be that way.
How old is she? 4?
Why don't you hit me with our...
27.
Wait till she's 14.
Very special internet.
Is he from... Where is he from?
Sweden.
Sweden? Yeah, why don't you hit us with our favorite Swedish reporter?
Well...
Don't hit us with him. Because he wouldn't be wearing a shirt, and that might be uncomfortable.
Or awesome, depending.
Oh, that's true. He does have cute hair.
Well, live from Sweden via an email we received yesterday... comes a report from International Lights, Camera, Cleveland correspondent Carrot Cake.
We need to get him like a badge or something.
A press badge.
Yeah.
He has sent us a report about the Guldbaggen. The 2014 Guldbaggen, which, as of course we all know, is the Golden Beetle Awards, which is the Swedish Oscars. Of sorts.
Oh, yeah, the Guldbaggen.
The Guldbaggen. Yeah.
Seems good to me.
So, winners and a short thing about each Guldbaggen award. Won't mention all the nominated and also will keep sections relatively short, except when I don't because my shirt is off. First up, Best Motion Picture. Atotrafin, or The Reunion, produced by Mathilde Didier, a movie about the school reunion and the one that wasn't invited, who later makes a short movie how the reunion could have been, and invites people over to watch it. As she was a victim of bullying and similar... The movie was given awards at Venedig and highly praised for the way it showed between fiction and reality in similar situation where bullying and other such aspects would be involved. Also, I watched this with my shirt off. Best Director? Per Fly. He got it for making the movie Monica Z, about the actress-singer of same name, Monica Z. He has earlier received Danish Award, Robert, and first time winning the Golden Beagle. Having made movies such as The Inheritance, though clearly not a huge name, you know what I'm saying. Best Actress in a Leading Role, Ida Magnusson, as Monica Zetterlund in... Monica Z, playing this famous Swedish actor slash singer. She actually was the first untrained actress to win the Golden Beetle herself. Monica Zetterlund, that is, you know what I'm saying. Edda Magnusson being a singer rather than actress doing the same, and this is her movie debut. And my shirt is off. Best Actor in Leading Role. Michael Persbrandt as Hasse in Migger Agen Hergenflag Negen Stogenbergen, or No One Owns Me. Playing the role of single father. A story of alcohol.
I can't believe we miss out on so many great Swedish films.
A story of alcohol.
He said that he wants to come visit. Maybe I'll make him bring some if he ever does.
And the child's situation, as well as love, betrayal, and politics in 1970s Sweden.
based on a novel of the same name, Hasse und Megan Gager Horken Schuflargenbogen, or No One Knows Me. Michael Persbrandt, having been nominated 6 times and won once before, also, a side note, is currently in Hobbit movies as Bjorn.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah, okay, okay.
Best screenplay, Anna Odell for Atterdraffen.
It was riveting.
Incredible.
Best makeup and hairstyling, Lisa Mustafa for We Are Best. We Are Best.
We Are Best, dude.
That was the documentary about our show.
Her first nomination and win. She has also worked on movies such as Anna Karenina and Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy, My Shirt Is Off. Best foreign movie. Is an important side note before beginning, 12 Years a Slave was nominated. Didn't win. Best foreign movie, Blue is the Warmest Color by Abdelatif Kachiche, a French-Turkish movie from the creator of Couscous and Black Venus.
Kenny's taking notes. He's going
to
watch these.
Well, I thought that it was going to go to Bad Grandpa. How did that not win Best Foreign Film?
Best actress in supporting role, Anna Bjelkerud, as Pernilla in Hotel. An actress that has been active since the late 80s and been in movies such as Call Girl from 2012. This was her first nomination and her first win. I took my shirt off to watch. And that is all, folks.
There we go, dude. Yay. Congratulations.
Well reported, Carrot Cake, my friend. There you have it.
12 Years a Slave lost to the director of Couscous.
There are a lot of surprises this year.
That's true. That's true.
I thought
we've been following these
Morgan
Swedish
Jorgensen
awards.
Was going to win an award.
Yeah. I thought the award, at least somebody with their shirt on, would get nominated.
Yeah.
But no one did.
No.
I don't know.
I mean, that could just be a cultural thing, maybe. Yeah.
Could be. I don't know.
Well, Slink, we got 10 minutes. Well, what do you want to do?
We're going to...
You want a preview review or you want to go to break?
I think in just a second here, we will take a break and then we'll come back and preview review and we may call it an evening.
I can live with that.
So, but, you know, before we go, Carrot Cake has one more message he'd like to reveal. He'd like to tell us about Lights, Camera, Cleveland appearing at Conuga this year.
Yeah, that's true.
On, when is Conuga? February
20-something. I don't have internet.
Yeah, it's in
21st through 23rd.
Do you remember the good old days when we could actually tell things without the internet?
You know, if I had known I wasn't going to have internet, I would have.
21st through 23rd, I did that.
Are you certain?
Sure.
Okay, yeah. February 21st through the 23rd. They said, so, Lights, Camera, Cleveland will be there doing a panel called Episode 1 Rules. Why the Star Wars prequels are not as bad as you remember.
We need to prep for that or we're going to get shredded.
Yeah, we do.
The location, Convention Center, Panel Room 17, on Friday from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. Attendees are encouraged to do so with their shirts off. Then on Saturday from 8 to 9 p.m., The Horror! The History of Horror Movies at the Choo Choo Gallery A. Attendees are encouraged to have their shirts off.
I think in both cases, shirts off will enhance your experience.
That's true. It's true.
According to Carrot Cake.
AMC Mike's shirt will be off.
Hello!
Kenny made the I'm not allowed to say any words right now.
I'm pretty sure he made yucky face, which I think I'm insulted by.
Ken Dog's like, I'm not even going to go because Kanuna is for babies.
It's not ucky face. It was just, he was waiting.
That was my hey-o.
Yeah, there's a storm a brewing. You're not going to go to the Chattanooga?
No, I'm going to Chattanooga.
All right.
I'm going to.
What are you going to dress like? What are you going to dress like?
Who do you think? What do you
Thor?
Think?
Thor? You're going to Thor it up?
That's what I got.
Ashley, I think, is reprising her role as Wonder Woman.
That's nice.
You know? The nerds seemed to like it last year.
And it's for the people. Who are you going to go as?
I'm trying to figure it out. I don't really know. Like,
you can do your Hagrid costume again.
Hagrid be all right. I need to spend some time getting a big thing of keys this time.
Yeah.
If I do that. Hagrid was good. I don't know. Like, who are some big, ginormous people in the comic books or the movies that I could do?
Put it back.
Huh.
Well, remember we researched a very horrible Juggernaut.
Yeah, I've always wanted to do Juggernaut if I could do it right.
Right.
Or super bad. Like either one is...
Right.
You know what I mean? Like either the worst Juggernaut costume ever or a really good one.
When you said super bad, I thought you meant Jonah Hill in super bad.
Yeah.
No, but I could do that.
Get Slinky to dress up like Michael Cera.
I think Slinky's whole family, I think we're doing...
Aren't you guys always Star Wars?
No.
The whole of Star Wars.
Yeah, we are
Aren't
the
you
Star
guys
Wars.
The Star Wars?
I was going to say, I don't...
Pew, 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 pew.
No, we are dressing up as...
I was going as Michael Cera. Because, you know, because it's the... I don't know if I should be there or if I should go. I don't know, man!
That was my Jonah Hill.
Thanks.
Dakota, do you want to tell everyone what you're going to dress up for at Chattanooga?
Toothless.
What?
Say it again.
Toothless.
She's going to be Toothless the Dragon.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and...
She makes Daddy go as Hiccup.
Yeah, and I'm going to be a random...
Other Viking.
Yeah.
And Other Viking!
Played by Mommy.
Maybe I could go as the big, ginormous dad from Brave. With the peg leg.
Yeah, you could be him. What about Amazing Spider-Man's coming out? Is Rhino going to be in this? Right? He's one of the sub-villains in that, isn't he?
I don't know.
Paul Giamatti.
Yep.
Paul Giamatti.
Played by Paul Giamatti. I don't get it. I don't get how they're going to do that.
I don't know.
But you could, if you could get a big gray, well, you know what? We don't even have
gray
to do that.
Gray sweatsuit and just put a horn on my forehead. A big gray sweatsuit.
Okay, but hear me out. What are your feelings on body paint?
Never stop believing.
Yeah, let's move on. We got 7 minutes. You want to
just dive into it?
Yeah,
go right into it.
Yeah.
They did wonders with Mystique.
Whatever. I'm going to think about this. I'm going to think about what
I'm not saying no.
Start up some kind of thing on the Lights, Camera, Cleveland face page so people could say what they want you to dress up as.
I just want to say, like, last year there was a fat greatest American hero,
mm-hmm.
and I loved it.
Yeah.
That dude was awesome, man. Like, so sometimes I think it'd be fun to do, like, a 6'3", 350-pound something that should be smaller.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, this type of thing, it's about just dressing up what you want to, you know. Nobody really makes fun of people for doing, at least they shouldn't.
I make fun of some of those people.
And they make fun of you then, too. Cause,
that's okay.
Oh, wow, yikes.
Well, no.
It's okay.
Be nice.
I'm just saying.
It's time for the preview! Grab a blow of a porridge!
Let's hit the preview review.
Who sponsors this, my friend?
It is our friends. Our friends at the Surf's Up Car Wash.
So dirty.
And they're keeping you so clean.
All right. Well, first up, we've only got two movies this week. First off, Labor Day. Labor Day stars Kate Winslet, Josh Brolin, and Clark Gregg. It's Jason Reitman's new film about a depressed single mom and her son who offer a wounded, fearsome man a ride. As police search town for the escaped convict, the mother and son gradually learn his true story, and their options become increasingly limited.
Ken Dog, what are you going to give it?
Your options are increasingly limited. You can only choose hate or great.
Did anybody ever see Mud?
No.
No, but it's also on Netflix. It was also one
is
of those.
Is it?
Ones. Yeah, I want to see Mud.
Yeah, I want to see Mud, too. It feels a little like that. I don't think it's high on my list because they're hitting the love story a little too hard. You know, the daddy left, but now there's this horrible man who, hey, maybe he's just misunderstood. We're going to let him live in our house. Hey, it's Uncle Convict that was hurt. I'm not going to say anything to the cops because he's not really dangerous. It seems like a horrible idea.
Yeah.
But they're lonely.
Sometimes people
bad decision makers making worse decisions.
So I'm going to hate it. Because
wait,
just...
were you referring to Josh Brolin and Kate Winslet agreeing to be in this movie? Bad decision makers making bad decisions.
Yeah, I'll be in that movie. Sure. That sounds great.
What does it pay?
Does it pay?
AMC Mike, what are you going to give it?
Oh, I'm hating it. There's, fair. It doesn't. Eh.
Slinky?
You know, I'm going to be with AMC Mike. I have very little to say other than just this movie reminds me that even some of the great actors can just sometimes phone it in, I guess. I mean,
I feel
just,
like we can't trust it. Josh Brolin anymore. I give it a hate.
Yeah.
He hurts my feelings.
Next up, That Awkward Moment. This is a new comedy starring Zac Efron, Michael B. Jordan, and Miles Teller. This is about three best friends who find themselves where we have all been, according to the sentence I'm reading, at that confusing moment in every dating relationship when you have to decide, where is this going? AMC Mike.
I ask myself that about my relationships all the time.
I ask about it at the radio show.
So,
where is this going?
Where is this going? It looks kind of
rom-com-y. Thankfully, Rob has the abs of Zac Efron, and so I feel like I can
at least...
You
know it.
You've got like five of them, don't you?
I've got one big ab.
Nice. I don't. It looks fun. It looks cute. I'm gonna grade it.
Ken Dog?
I accidentally watched the Red Band trailer of this.
Oh, so you saw the giant wiener.
And
oh, it's that kind of dress-up party.
It's perplexed me. And I'll tell you why. Because you watch it and you're like, it's a rom-com.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of. And then you watch it and you go,
it's Swingers.
It's like a dirty rom-com.
Yeah, it's like a vulgar
rom-com.
And so I'm torn. I think I hate it, though.
I love it. Okay, you know, I have long said I have this weird little place in spot in my heart. Like, I think Zac Efron,
I think it's in your heart.
I don't know.
It's somewhere.
I think Zac Efron actually is more talented than we have allowed him to be.
Sure.
And I think that this movie kind of looks like it looks like a romantic comedy in the vein of Swingers. And I you know, at that time in my life I liked Swingers, and so this one looks stupid and funny to me. I'm going to grade it.
Okay, I'll go through this really quickly.
But not going to be for everyone.
Right, I'll go through this really quickly. Number one, giving it a hate. Number two, I also think, though, that Zac Efron is underrated. I think that he's better than people think. I just don't think so in this movie.
I'm going to watch him in Neighbors.
Yeah. Number three.
He does look funny in Neighbors.
One of my biggest problems is that Miles Teller is a cheap man's Jonah Hill. And
well,
he bugs me.
Which is ironic, because you remember when Jonah Hill was a cheap man's Seth Rogen?
Yeah, except for that then they became friends and made it okay.
And now Seth Rogen is like a cheap man's Jonah Hill.
Yeah, that's getting true.
Not as funny skinny.
And let us not forget that in top billing of this movie is someone named Imogene Poots.
What?
So anytime a movie stars someone named Imogene Poots, like,
I've got to give it a
hate. I can't.
I think I'm going to change mine based on that.
Starring Imogen Poots.
All right, guys. Come see us at Conuga if you're going to be there. It's going to be pretty exciting. We'll put our information up about when we're doing the things. We're at lightscameracleveland.com. Until next time, I'm the Hollywood Slinky, and I love movies.
I'm AMC Mike, and I love movies.
I'm the Ken Dog, and I like movies.
I'm Rob, and I love movies.
Let's all love movies together.
Imogen Poots.
I got movies.
Imogen Poots. It was a heist film.
I wish you could
Imogen Poots.
I
You talking about that
Western?
It was a heist movie.
I'm doing a panel at Chattanooga proving it was Western.
Nothing will keep us. Imogen Poots.
No Imogen Poots.
You've been listening to Lights Camera.
Take my money and you can take my pride. You can take that.